Sandra Postel, and I'm going to play her a video that allows us to get a sense of Sandra from a perspective of her vision for water. And then Sandra will join us live for a few moments. So Joe, stay close. We'll bring you back to help with the Q&A.
It destroys freshwater ecosystems. We are at a tipping point. The good news is that we can fix this. The key solution to maintaining freshwater forever is really to grasp our connection to water. The fact that water is the basis of life. And more we're starting to think in this concept of one water, that there's only so much there to be shared, not only among ourselves, but among all of terrestrial life. We need to think of and manage water in a creative way and figure out ways we can productively reuse it. More than 70% of all the water that we withdraw from rivers and lakes and groundwater goes to irrigated agricultures. So everything that we use and wear and buy and eat every day takes water to make, and sometimes a surprisingly large amount of water. A simple cotton shirt can take up to 700 gallons of water to make, 34 gallons for one cup of coffee. The typical burger can take as much as 630 gallons of water. So just thinking about it in terms of our energy use, our material consumption, our diets, it creates some really good opportunities to think about how we can shrink our personal water footprint. And I think that's a really empowering thing for people to realize that it's not just the problem needing to be solved out there, but our choices can make a difference. I will remain deeply sad that species have been lost because of what we've done up to now. But I do remain hopeful that we can turn this around. And that hope is based on realism. I've seen these examples out in the world where farmers are choosing to irrigate more efficiently. Ranchers are choosing to raise cattle in a way that's actually good for the land. I've seen cities begin to adopt wetlands and green infrastructure to capture stormwater. If we love water and what it does for the planet and for other life on the planet, then we want to change to be part of the solution. And I think that's the thing that's most important.
Okay, I think I need to stop the sound there. Welcome, Sandra. Please turn your camera on and join us. And Tanya, please get ready to join us as well. You know, it's taken a while, Sandra, for us to get to this moment. Too many emails. You were early on this journey with us, in a sense, when we were looking at a live event. You heard from me that long ago. And COVID has come, and COVID has connected us in ways we never thought we would be connected, and also asked us to distance and be mindful of one another in the midst of the pandemic. So we're learning as a species new things, right?
I hope so. We are.
Yes. So I just want to let the audience know how special it is for us to have you. My book list is growing. You are prolific. You write like crazy. And I love it. We're doing a book club on Replenish, by the way.
Wonderful.
And I want to let you know that. And so for the audience, I just want to let you know that Sandra, she directs the Independent Global Water Policy Project. And of course, she's busy doing what she's doing right here today. And she does have many, her calendar is quite full. I do know that, with lecturing and writing and also consulting on global water issues. She is, for us in this area of work, a leading authority and an internationally recognized leader and visionary in this work. And so many of us are inspired by her. We see her innovative and practical approach as something that everybody can understand. And this is a summit geared to speak to people, everyday folk like you and I, who just want to know that there is a future that's possible and want to get engaged. Sandra brings this conversation in a way we can understand. And for that, she has been recognized with a prestigious Stockholm Water Prize Award. She is 2021's Water Laureate, and it's very much deserved. I can go on, but I invite you to go hang out at her website, globalwaterpolicy.org. And so we want to just take this short little window of time that we have with you, Sandra, to see if there's any questions from the audience. And while we're looking those up, and Joe, I'm sure we'll have a question for you. If there's anything from what you've been with us for a little bit, I noticed you there. If there's anything you just want to add or say before we lob our first question at you, please do so.
I just wanted to say I so appreciated the presentations, Myra, that we just got from Kim and Olivia. It's amazing to me that this watershed of the Mississippi encompasses, 41% of the continental United States, and so much of our history and our culture and our ecology is in this space, and yet there's so much we can do to make the watershed itself, a greater gift to the cities, the towns, the farmers, the industries, everyone that lives in it and depends on it. And I think we heard some of those ideas, today. And, one of the things that I wrote about in Replenish, I have a section on the Mississippi, and, that the 1927 flood was just a defining moment that, that flooding, and I agree with Kim, that would be great to have a different word, water surge or something that doesn't have quite the fear, attached to it. The idea that, that we need to somehow figure out how to live with ecosystems, with river systems that have these hydrologic movements. And, I think after, it was after that terrible year in 1927 when, the idea of floodways began to come in, that we need to sort of have an exit ramp, from the Mississippi flood for, protecting downstream. But that didn't help the ecosystem. It may help control flooding, and they've been important in many ways. But, what Olivia was talking about and Kim, the idea of, just letting the river be a river in strategic locations where we can do that. And the multitude of benefits that can come from reconnecting the Mississippi with portions of its floodplain, to recharge groundwater, to remove some of those nitrogen loads and let the land do what it can do, to store that water. I don't know if you remember that after the 2011 flood in the Mississippi, which was really a quite horrific flood, followed again by what we saw in 2019, but the next year, 2012, was a serious drought. And had we stored more of that flood water in wetlands, in the floodplain, the effect of the drought the very next year could have been mitigated a bit. You know, we might not have seen so much damage to the shipping and to agriculture and so on. And so, you know, I think that resilience that comes from the kinds of solutions Kim and Olivia were talking about is super important. You know, I have to say, when I wrote Replenish, I've been working on water for decades, but I had not myself, you know, paid enough attention to the soil reservoir. The idea that globally, you know, soils can hold 8 times as much water as all the world's rivers combined, but we don't really manage it that way. You know, and so as Olivia pointed out, you know, for every 1% increase in carbon in a healthier soil, we're able to store, in some cases, 20,000 more gallons of water per acre. Well, that's resilience to farmland also, right? Because if you have that water in the soil and a drought comes along, you might not have as serious a loss of crops. You might actually sustain your yield. And so these are things I think we can educate the public about. And, you know, I think it must have been incredibly disappointing, you know, to see the lack of interest in having a water management strategy in the upper basin. And to me, it's a need to educate the public, really, to reach out. And, you know, we're so accustomed to letting the engineers handle our water issues, and they've in many ways done a fabulous job. Most of us don't think about water beyond turning on the tap. But I think these are more holistic questions and more holistic solutions. And I think education, so that we can start to get these kinds of solutions scaling up, I think would be super important.
Just what I wanted to hear, your thoughts on all of that. And so you really went there in a way that I think is instrumental and complements that conversation that came on. I mean, Replenish does speak to these things. And, you know, part of what was in the video with regard to your vision gives us another window, too, at how we impact the waters that support us, the fresh waters, through our buying decisions. I mean, just one t-shirt is a mind blower, isn't it, of how much fresh water is used in that. But it's equally important that we understand the biome is all participating in the flow and abundance of water, which is what you speak to when you talk about the capacity of soil. And that depleted soil can't be fully present to its own task. I understand from soil scientists, we only know 3% about soil. We know more about the ocean and space than we do about soil. Mm. It truly is a major frontier. And we're learning a lot about how it ensures flow. But this question of flooding is the interesting one, isn't it? I'm going to invite up for you, Sandra, before we let you go, two more to this window. So be prepared, production, to spotlight them. I'd like Sabrina Brewer, our rapporteur from Colorado College. We have rapporteurs each day, Sandra, that are summarizing the day, and they'll be writing a document. So I'd love for Sabrina, if you have a question for Sandra, please go ahead and pose it.
Hi, Sandra. Thank you for coming on to speak with us today.
Oh, it's a pleasure. Thank you.
Well, I'm studying education in college, so I was interested in your comments about educating the public and what you consider to be the most effective way to reach out to people and make them care about these issues.
That's a great question. It's a really great question. I, one of the things that I try to do is to start with ourselves. You know, I think we often have trouble relating to water management or water policy. And I think if we start with our own understanding, our own water footprint, so to speak, you know, and, you know, so many of us, when we think about our water use, we think only about the water that's coming out of the tap at home. We turn on the tap, we turn on the shower, there's our water use. And it's so easy to not remember that everything we eat takes a lot of water to make. Our clothes, our computers, turning on a light is using water, right? And so I think that footprint concept brings water home to people. And then when you think about, okay, gosh, I just this morning I had a cup of coffee. I really had already had one. I threw it down the drain. My goodness, that was 34 gallons of water equivalent to make that cup of coffee that you just threw, you know, went down the drain. So not wasting can be a great way to start people on, you know, a road of conservation in a sense. And if my coffee beans were from Ethiopia, grown somewhere there, or Guatemala, my footprint lands there. So to say, connects us to water all around the world, just starting from our cup of coffee in the morning. And it's not to make people feel guilty. I love coffee, I'm gonna have coffee, but it's to make us aware, right? And, you know, and Myra mentioned the 700 gallons to make a t-shirt. Well, do I really need 25 t-shirts in my drawer? You know, so there are all ways we can be part of the solution if we learn about that water footprint and then understand from there, it takes us out. You know, if we think about, you know, the watershed that our water at home comes from, then we connect to that river, we connect to that reservoir, whatever it is, or to the groundwater. So I think it's that connection that I would really try to achieve with education, because then it gives people a sense of participation, of empowerment to be part of the solution. And it doesn't feel like the problem is out there and the solutions are out there, that, you know, we're all connected, you know, through this. And to be optimistic about the fact that we can solve this problem together. I think that's really important.
Well, thank you, Sabrina. We're gonna not hold Sandra much longer, but before we say goodbye, we have one last thing. We can't let the 2021 Water Laureate out just yet. Tanya, go ahead. It's all yours.
Yes. Hello, Sandra. It's a great privilege to have an opportunity to gift you Iron Water Drop.
Oh.
For your 2021 Water Laureate. Iron Water Drop, it's a crystal glass water craft I designed to educate about and inspire love and respect for water.
Mm. Oh my.
So I will be sending Iron Water Drop to you as soon as you receive your mailing address. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to thank you for the wonderful work you're doing, especially in the water restoration.
Oh, Tanya, thank you so much. It's beautiful.
Yes, I hope you enjoy it.
I will treasure it, really. Thank you so much.
Thank you. It was designed for people like you.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sandra, for your time today.
It's been a pleasure, really.
Hope to find ways to engage you more in the future.
And I'm going to be tuning in during the week, so I hope to see more. Yeah, thank you.
All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Well,